Well, I want to thank you first and foremost and clarify some things. You've heard the term that I'm elder attached here, and some of you are wondering and worried that why is this not an elder married? Okay, give you a few seconds to get. Elder attached is our conference's way of saying that a pastor with primary responsibilities elsewhere is a worshiper with you in a local conference like Aldersgate. So thank you for being a family to my family and to me in the past year as we transitioned back from the U.S., back home to Singapore, and we continue to worship with you. So I have the nice privilege of coming in incognito on Sundays and worshiping with you. Usually I sit next to Kennedy at the back. But thank you for being a family and loving us and welcoming us here at Aldersgate. For those of you who are interested, I'll be starting to teach at Trinity Theological College in January, and I'll be teaching in the subjects of Christian education and leadership. So pray for me. Pray even more for the poor students who have to deal with me. But seriously speaking, I hope to enjoy that learning journey with them, and as I always say, we learn together. Today is the sixth Sunday in which you talk about the Sabbath. Gao liao la. A lot, right? But you know what? I want to thank God for our PIC, Reverend Dr. Lynette Satyasingam, because she is doing something that most Protestant churches neglect. We have a very thin theology on the Sabbath. So it's good that as a church, we've been grappling with this for these past few weeks. And today we come to the last session, but I pray that we will be attentive to God as we look at this topic. Turn with me to Mark chapter 2, verse 23 to 28. Or tap and scroll there if you like. Mark chapter 2, verses 23 to 28. One Sabbath, Jesus was going through the grain fields, and as his disciples walked along, they began to pick some heads of grain. The Pharisees said to him, "Look, why are they doing what is unlawful on the Sabbath?" He answered, "Have you never read what David did when he and his companions were hungry and in need? In the days of Abiathar the high priest, he entered the house of God and ate the consecrated bread, which is lawful only for priests to eat. And he also gave some to his companions." Then he said to them, "The Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. So the Son of Man is Lord even of the Sabbath." This is the word of God. Thanks be to God. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, help us be attentive to your presence amongst us this morning. Even as we sang and prayed earlier, Lord, you are already here. Help us to turn our ears to you, turn our eyes to you, and turn our hearts to you. Come, Holy Spirit, and we want to give you permission to work in our hearts, to shape our thinking, and help us to be obedient, Lord, to change the way we live. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. In Mark chapter 2, Jesus tells us two important things about the Sabbath for his disciples. The first thing is this, that the Sabbath was made for man. Turn to your neighbor and tell them, it is for your good. It's great. This is a much more obedient congregation than the earlier one. Sabbath was made for our good. The second thing that Mark chapter 2, Jesus tells us is that Jesus is the Lord of the Sabbath. Lord of the Sabbath. We've heard so much about the Sabbath, but how much Sabbathing is there going on in our lives? It was clearly very important for the Jews. We've heard about how important it was. It was not just a ritual, a weekend thing to do, a religious habit. It went to the core of the identity of the Jews and their sense of place in the present and in the time to come. But it's clearly not very important for us Protestants. How many of us observe a strict 24-hour Sabbath? Anyone? Really? No one? What did you do this morning when you woke up before coming to church? How many of you went to run for a jog? Not running for the bus, that one don't count. How many of you went to the gym? Oh, equally unhealthy congregation. People like me. Okay, how many of you made breakfast? Yeah, work lah. Bang, lose already. It's clearly not very much into our DNA as Protestants. It's something that we don't really think about, because for most of us, our Sabbath thing is going to church. Oh, yeah. It's one of those things that I have to do on Sunday, otherwise I feel uneasy, unholy. If I've gone to church, I'm holy, I'm okay. I've done my thing for the week. Is that your Sabbath? Oh, I got many things to do this today. Maybe I just go for the early service, quick one, and then get on with the day. I just thought that 2 weeks ago. So I'm just like you. It's something that we think about in terms of the extent of our Sabbath as Protestants is thin. So what exactly are we supposed to do? What are you planning to do this afternoon, immediately after this service? What? Lunch? Yes. After that? If it wasn't November, if this was, say, January, some of you will be headed to the tuition center. Your poor kids. Poor thing like you also. Many of you here are breathing a sigh of relief. PSLE is finally over. The exam for the parents is over. Clearly, Sabbath is not something that we treat very important. This commandment seems almost optional. So what is so important about the Sabbath? It's so important that we just spent 6 Sundays talking about it. It is, after all, a commandment. How do we square this? Clearly, we are not bound in the same way to observe Sabbath like the Jews. In fact, Jesus' actions and response in the Gospel of Mark chapter 2 signals that he has inaugurated a new way of looking at the laws and especially the Sabbath. The commandments and the Sabbath are still in force. But our Lord has changed our lenses and the way we interpret it decisively. Here, Jesus pushes past the rules to the purpose of Sabbath. He tells us that he is the Lord on the Sabbath. This is important. Jesus is the Lord of the Sabbath. It's not about rules. It's not about the religious who make those rules. We, like the Pharisees, are reminded to acknowledge the originator, the giver of the command. The focus and the worship during Sabbath is Jesus. So that's the purpose. And the beneficiaries of the Sabbath, you and I. We are the beneficiaries of the Sabbath. We are not servants of a ritual. The observance of Sabbath is for our good. Turn to Colossians chapter 2, verses 16 to 17. Colossians chapter 2, 16 to 17. It says here in Paul's letter to the Colossians, "Therefore, do not let anyone judge you by what you eat or drink, or with regard to a religious festival, a new moon celebration, or a Sabbath day. These are a shadow of the things that were to come. The reality, however, is found in Christ. Human rules are imperfect ways of trying to interpret the laws and intent of God. But we are reminded that they are shadows. They are not the primary source. They are shadows formed by the light, the source. The light, the source, is Christ. The reality that is found in Christ is that we have been set free. For freedom, Christ has set us free, we are told in the letter to the Galatians. So we are no longer bound by the Jewish rules about Sabbath. But what exactly have we been freed to do instead? In Paul's letter to Galatians chapter 5, in verse 13, it says this: "For you have been called to live in freedom, my brothers and sisters, but don't use your freedom to satisfy your sinful nature. Instead, use your freedom to serve one another in love." And then in a few verses later, in 16, he says, "So I say, let the Holy Spirit guide your lives." We have spiritual freedom to express our worship and obedience to God. But it is not a license to indulge in ourselves. When we tell people you're free, sometimes we take that too far. And we think we're free to do anything we want. But here Paul says that freedom is not to be abused by our indulgence in ourselves. We have freedom in expressing our love and worship to God, and we can use this freedom to serve others in love, because that is a worship to God. So as Christians, we are not bound to keep Sabbath in all its intricate rules, but we are commanded, urged, and invited to be kept by the Sabbath, rejoicing in it as a gift from God to us. What kind of gift is the Sabbath? It is a gift of rest, divine rest. Turn to your neighbor and say, "Don't sleep now." For some of us, hearing the word rest is actually quite scary. We cannot stop one. We are workaholics. We must do something. If not, we will feel uneasy. Some of us will go mad if there's no music in the background. Some of us, you ask them to go silent retreat, it's like asking them to go and die. Rest. Here, we're going to find out what it means. Turn with me to Hebrews chapter 4, verses 9 to 11. This is important. So go and tap and scroll to there. Or turn to your Bibles. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 9 to 11. It says in the letter to the Hebrews, "There remains then a Sabbath rest for the people of God. For anyone who enters God's rest also rests from their works, just as God did from His. Let us therefore make every effort to enter that rest, so that no one will perish by following the example of disobedience." The Sabbath is an invitation to us to receive God's gift of a godly rest. To not rest, according to the writer of Hebrews, is somehow related to disobedience. To not rest is to think we know better than the Creator. Our Creator knows that we need rest. Yet we reject that, as if it was optional. We are told instead to make every effort to enter the rest. Why are we to do so? Why make every effort to enter God's rest? Letter of Hebrews says, so that you will not perish. Wow, so serious. So serious. The writer of Hebrews points us to a connection between unrest anxiety, busyness, with disobedience, with sin, with perishing. Perhaps our problems with the Sabbath is a sign of our struggle. It is an expression or a sign of our struggle to live into our faith and discipleship. Perhaps a struggle of our ability or inability to let go and let God. The question of how to observe the Sabbath is perhaps better answered by asking ourselves, why is it that we struggle with Sabbath? Why do you struggle with Sabbath? Don't think for the whole church now. Just think for each of us, each of you. Why do you struggle with Sabbathing? There are so many things that cry out for our attention, isn't there? How many of us have returned home to see a stack of dishes to be done? My wife and I discovered a miracle when we went to the US. It's called a dishwasher. You need to know the secret, come to us later. Many things that cry out for our attention. Our children, feeding them, teaching them, scolding them, worrying for them. Work, it never ends. It now reaches out even after office hours. Office hours is a myth nowadays, as ever since WhatsApp and texting and emails. I see a lot of you smiling. My commiserations, brothers and sisters. It comes into our homes, interrupts our conversations with our spouse, with our children, interrupts our rest, even our sleep. There are many things that cry out for our attention, not least our entertainment. There it comes, guys. Our Korean drama. Okay, let's not be biased, not just Korean drama, other drama also. It's Netflix, gaming, YouTube. Screens and more screens. There are phone screens, there are laptop screens, iPad screens that we are buried in all the time now. TV screens, advertisement screens, even if you drive down Orchard Road, also must get another screen. Nowadays, you have multiple screens because you have your car screen, then you have your phone screen. Some of you have a few, especially if you Grab or you're a Grab driver. Last time, if you have multiple phones, it's because you are a bookie. Not everyone is a bookie. If you are a young person and don't understand what that means, later we have lunch, okay? Screens everywhere. And if you travel on the buses or MRT, you know of people whose screens never leave their eyes. It's amazing they can navigate intricate MRT journeys without lifting their eyes from their screens. Have you seen that? They are the ones who bump into you, lah. We are oblivious to the world and yet captivated by the world. Many things cry out for our attention. Turmoil in the world. We turn on social media and see everyone arguing with each other. Everyone is right. Everyone is wrong. Turn on the news and there's trouble everywhere. We feel troubled. And our conversations are troubled. And even the church, there are things that cry out for our attention. So many programs, so many meetings. Good things. But have they become a distraction even? Have we unwittingly become Marthas instead of Marys? Of course, there is ourselves. We ourselves cry out for attention. I want. I need. I need a break. I need rest. I need sleep. I need peace of mind. I want a loving word, a loving touch. We need friendship, companionship, fulfillment. We need to feel needed, important, that we matter. Many things cry out for our attention. I wonder what we will be rushing to today after the service. So we are all busy with a myriad of activities like hamsters on a wheel. Perhaps we don't know we can stop. Perhaps we don't know how to stop. Perhaps we don't know if we want to stop. Today, the Word of God says to you and I that you can stop and you must stop. Each of you, all of us, must choose whether we want to stop. That's the case. Let me talk about how we can stop. I'm going to suggest to you to think of Sabbath in this way. After 6 weeks, maybe a simple way of thinking of Sabbath is to think of Sabbath as paying attention to God. Turn to your neighbor, say, pay attention to God. Hey, you haven't done it. Come on. Sabbath as a way of paying attention to God. I think our struggle is because we misunderstand the gift Jesus offers us and what Sabbath represents. It is not rest only in terms of sleep or making up for the sleep deficit that you incurred this past week. Sabbath offers us a pause, a break, even a turning away from how we imagine and do life, how we imagine and do family, how we imagine and do work, how we imagine and do entertainment, how we imagine and deal with the turmoil and conflicts in our world, how we imagine and do relationships, and yes, how we imagine and do church, and how we imagine and live our lives. Sabbath invites us to pay attention to God by stilling ourselves and know God. This means to pay attention to God. And this paying attention to God is a worship and exalting of God. Be still. We sung that earlier. It comes from Psalm 46. Let me read for you what Psalm 46, 9 to 10 says. It talks about our God who makes wars cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear, and he burns the shields with fire. When you read this, you think of physical wars, countries having wars, but think about wars in terms of conflict in your lives, relationship, problems at work or with family, with your spouse, with your children. So hear it again. He makes wars cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the shields with fire. He says, be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. Is God exalted in you? Is God exalted by you? Is God exalted in the way we live our lives? The psalmist connects being still with the worship and the exalting of God. Our Lord Jesus says to us, come to Him and He will give us rest. Matthew 11, verses 28 to 30, Jesus says to us those familiar but perhaps ignored words, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Paying attention to God is to turn to Him, is to go to Him, and to replace our perspective, our rules, our priorities, our preoccupations, our busyness, our anxieties, worries, hopes, pains, and struggles with Him. Him alone, God alone. Paying attention to God's Sabbath is an ultimate act of worship and offering of our whole selves, our whole lives, our whole attention. That's something our world doesn't know much about. Giving whole attention. We are a very distracted age. Some of us are older here. We remember a time when there was less distractions. But if you are growing up in today's world, as my children are and as we live in, it is becoming more and more a distracted age. An act of worship by the people of God, giving whole attention to God, that's good news. How then do we Sabbath? How do we be still and pay attention to God? There are many ways to do this, and we have freedom, we are told by Paul, in how we express and experience Sabbath. We can Sabbath to the extent of our faith in God, to the extent of our circumstances. Brothers and sisters, if you can Sabbath for only an hour, then pay God full attention for that hour. If you can Sabbath for a whole day, plan on paying attention to God for that day. Whatever your expression of Sabbath, let's learn to make every effort to enter that rest more and more. So perhaps you start with an hour. Perhaps you can learn to Sabbath more and more. 2 hours, 4 hours, whatever it is. Sabbath is more than just ceasing to work and rules about what is or is not work. It is to pay attention to God. It is to shift our agenda to God's agenda. To follow not our own schedule, but God's rhythm and pace. To be in pace with the Holy Spirit so that we can be in step with Him. Sabbath goes beyond a reset back to all or existing practices. You all reset your phones, right? Sometimes it gets a bit glitchy and you shut it down and you restart. If you're not an Apple user, you restart your computer. Or if you're an Apple user nowadays, more and more bugs, so you do have to shut down from time to time. But that's not what Sabbath is about. It's not what Sabbath is about. Sabbath is not a reset. Because Sabbath is not going back to your old and existing practices. It is to pay fresh attention to our shepherd's voice. Fresh attention to God's activity and presence in our life and society right now. Paying fresh attention to what God may want us to be and what God may want us to do. And in perhaps completely new and seemingly surprising ways. Paul tells us what this is all about in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5. He says, "We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God, and we take captive every thought and to make it obedient to Christ." Sabbath is an act of worship and discipleship as we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. That's what Sabbathing is about. Paying attention to God. Paying fresh attention. And we can do so, we can Sabbath in so many different ways. We can enjoy God's presence walking through the forest on the beach. We can marvel at creation, the birds, and in one area that this church is very good at, marvel at the not just the birds, but the butterflies. All the butterfly uncles here. Marvel at the birds, the butterflies, the buayas, the real crocodiles like Sungai Buloh, and some say in Johor Bahru too. Or even praying for people as you meander through the shopping center. Oh, I saw a lot of heads lift up. Yeah, you can Sabbath in a shopping center, don't you know? Now you're thinking, this guy's gone off his rockers. Perhaps. You can be praying for people as you meander through a shopping center, not with buying shoes on your mind, but saving souls in your heart. That's where the people are. John Wesley always went to where the people were.
That's where our people are. You want a gospel to reach other people? Well, that's one place where people are gathered.
We can Sabbath by reading the scripture and spending times of devotion with our family. My family has a practice every Sunday night for many years now. We have family devotions. Kids take part. Everyone has a different role each week. The kids help with the singing and choosing of songs and leading it. My youngest one now clamors to take over the teaching. Perhaps. There are different ways to Sabbath. We can invite strangers, neighbors, or families to our table. I remember years ago as a student in England, in Leicester, I went to a church, an evangelical free church, and every Sunday after church, families would open their tables and homes to all the poor, literally poor students. And we would go to their homes for, you know, Yorkshire pudding and roast beef or other things. It was not the food, it was really the welcome and the love that they showed us that has stuck with me all these years. How about opening your table to others as an act of Sabbathing, of loving, of worship, as an intentional way of paying attention to what God is doing in other people's lives as well? Sabbathing by reaching out to persons who need friendship, feeding, praying, playing with, and caring for those who are foreigners in our midst, migrant workers, domestic helpers, or singing, being silent, praying, and listening. All these things are ways for us to Sabbath. All these things, and all the time, holding Jesus' hand and seeing what the Lord sees, asking what is on our Father's heart, and where the Spirit is leading us. How else could you pay attention to God? How will you Sabbath? It's not a rhetorical question. It's not a question for me to answer. It's a question for you to answer. So in your hearts right now, would you think about that? How will you Sabbath? If you're already doing something, good. If you're already Sabbathing, good. If you've got some bright idea and want to tell your husband and wife, go and tell them right now. Don't wait. Turn to them and say, hey, we can do this, huh? How will you Sabbath? We all need divine rest. A rest that is not just physical and temporary, but a resting in the Lord all the time. And I tell you, this can be a powerful witness and example to our troubled, anxious, fractious world. They need this. This is the good news. The people of God who know the peace of God. The people of God who live in the presence of God. They don't need a snazzy evangelistic slogan. They need to see the reality of Christ in us. That's the good news. Our distractions, our fractions, our constant actions only lead to dissatisfaction. And Jesus invites us away from all that noise and hubbub, all the pretensions to real rest that can only be found in the presence of God, by paying attention to God. I pray this day, as I have prayed for many years, that we will all share a holy dissatisfaction with unholy mediocrity. Let us desire what Jesus offers instead, divine rest, all the time. Sabbath is a spiritual metaphor for not just one day, but for all the time, for us to be attentive to the presence, the voice, rest, direction of God. The command and invitation of Sabbath, which we can experience and express with freedom,
is not only a source of joy for us as Christians. Yes, it's a joy, but it's more than that. This Sabbath thing and practice of Sabbath is an exorcism of the demonic spirit and voices of our times. It is an antidote and vaccine for the diseases of busyness, distractions, and never-ending turmoil that turn us all away from God and make us and the world gods unto ourselves. Today, the Word of God says you can Sabbath and you must Sabbath. And we have learned about the freedom of how we can Sabbath. Each of you, all of us, must choose whether we want to Sabbath. Choose and then act on it. Amen.